بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Hello my students, welcome back to the channel. And in this video, I'm going to explain about our next topic for curriculum and course design class. And today's topic is actually about contextual analysis, okay? We will learn about contextual analysis, but I think I need to tell you this. That my slides that I'm going to tell you later on will be from Nation and Grace. I mean, the slides are not from them, but I just got the ideas from these two resources or from these two references. The first is from Nation and McAllister, and the second one is from Graves. My presentation today is actually like a summary for this topic taken from these two references, okay? I hope you can listen and try to understand my explanation. And if you don't understand my explanation, or you think that I have a wrong explanation for the topics, you can comment or ask me later on in our group or through Google Classroom, okay? Or you can also comment actually here, I mean, on the column section on YouTube. Well, without further ado, I think it would be better if I just start my first slide. For today's topic, that is contextual analysis, I think to have this kind of look, I mean, my slide will be good, I think, to let you know and to help you define what context actually is. Without having a formal definitions or without consulting our dictionary about what context actually is, I think you know what context actually is. Context is actually about a situation, okay, a situation or the condition that we face or we have. And since our class is all about curriculum and course design, so we're going to talk about teachers and also students teaching and learning process. So it means that the context that I'm going to talk to you right now in this video is all about teaching, okay? So teaching, teachers' condition, learners' conditions, teaching and learning process. So that's the situation for the context. Okay, let's see here. I have two different parts in my slide. The first slide, I mean, not first slide, the first part is a sentence, and sentence is every teacher faces different contexts. I think without having further information about analysis and how to do analysis for context, I think you need to know this first on how that every teacher will face different contexts, and every teacher faces real different contexts. Of course, one teacher, if we compare one teacher to another, they will have different situation for their teaching and learning process in a classroom. That's why you have to underline. To analyze a context to design a course, you have to have in mind that you as a teacher will have different, okay, different contexts or a different situation with your friends, with other teachers, and with other schools. That's why I also put some notes or some points on the right side. I wrote junior high school, senior high school, vocational high school, and boarding schools. Of course, if you are or we are a teacher at junior high school, the condition that we face is not similar to senior high school condition, okay? And it is, of course, different from vocational high school or boarding school. So it means that in every school, the difference can come from the different schools and different location, different condition, different students. Okay, so any kind of situation we face. And you know, to define a context actually depends on the context itself in which a teacher teaches. So that's the point, okay? It becomes different because a teacher teaches in different school, a teacher teaches in different class, a teacher teaches in different level, a teacher teaches different human beings, a teacher teaches in different conditions of mission and vision from the school. Like boarding school, they will have special vision and missions for the students, not like a teacher teaches at junior high school, I mean public schools. Of course that we have to know the informations for our teaching so that we can design the best course or the best design for the curriculum, I mean for our teaching later on. Well, we'll go to this next slide. This slide is talking about the idea for analyzing context, and you may see over here that the context is a key factor. A key factor for what? Okay, so I put also two different questions. The first is, what does context mean? I think number one, we have been clear about this number one. And the second, why is it important to define one's context? What do you think? Why is it important to define one's context? If you know the answer, I think you may comment on the comment sections or let me know in our group, or just wait for my answer. I think it is not difficult to answer why is it important to define one's context, because if we design a curriculum or we design a course for a specific students, for a specific school, for a specific level, of course we have to know the context. And the reason why it is important to define that context is to have a right decision, okay, a right decision for our teaching. So that's the answer. If you have a portrait or you have an insight for your teaching and learning condition, of course that you know what to do, what is right to do, which one is better, which one is not, which one is applicable and which one is not applicable. That is why we have to define the context, because the students we face in every semester, the students we face in every year in different school or in different classes, they are all different with different age, a different year, okay, different month, different day, okay? So you have to know the surrounding, you have to know the situation or the context where you're teaching to help you, okay? Another answer, another different answer, but the answer is actually the same. I mean, the idea, only the way I explain it to you is different. So the main reason is to help you, okay? To help teachers to decide, okay? To make a decision for their teaching, okay? Their actual teaching, actually. What else? Context is important to give you insight to decide your daily teaching, how to teach and what to teach, okay? That's my note, actually. I have a kind of a small note over here, and I have my own map as usual. So before I present the materials to you, I also have my own notes. Sometimes I also look down, it means that I'm looking for my note. Maybe I'm reading my notes, but these are only the points, okay? You and I, we are actually learning. So I'm still learning about how to design a course and how to analyze the context. That's why before explaining the materials, I also read the books and I try to have my own notes like this, my own map and even my own slides, even the ideas are coming from the books I mentioned before. Okay, we'll continue here. What does subtext mean? Even we had already defined that before in the previous slide, I think you need to see this too. Designing a course is similar to designing a house. This is actually not a real definition for context in course design, but this is only an analogy on how that the context is very important in our teaching. So before you design your course, I mean, the syllabus, the lesson plans, the materials that you are going to use for your class, you have to have, as I mentioned again and again, that to have an insight or portrait for your class is very important. And Graves said in this analogy that designing a course is similar to designing a house. You know, if we design a house, or we want to build a house, of course that we've got to make sure we have, I think, not we have to, but actually people, okay, actually people. I mean, my family, when I wanted to build a new house or design a new house, I will think about the construction, okay, the budget I have. And what about the rooms? How many rooms I have? How many rooms I want to design, or about the magnitude, actually, the size of the house, okay? We think about the size of the house, how many rooms in that house, and what about our budgets, and what are the materials we need to build that house. And designing, of course, is also similar to that designing a house. So we need a preparation before. We have to have a planning about our class. What will the class about? Okay, what will the class about, and who the students are? And who the students are, what about the location, the situation in that school? Okay, so those kind of information are important so that we can have a good result. So the result will be suitable with our planning. I mean, the result will not ruin the concept of the teaching or the goals of teaching that we design or the government provided for us. And here, from these 3 points, look at number one, lot of investigation. So this is lot of investigation. Lot of investigation is one of the ways to know about the context, okay? The way to figure out the context for our teaching, for our course, I mean, you have, not you, but we as teacher, we need to have a lot of investigation. And investigation is for digging information about the things that I mentioned here. So like, what is the level of the students? How long the course? How long the course is? I'm sorry, I missed time over here. I think I'll try. I will correct that mistake in my writing. Where is it? I guess it's still here. Okay, how long the course is? I'm sorry. How long the course is? How long the course is? Where's the course to give place? Okay. I think that's okay. As long as you understand, I mean, I think that's not a big problem, actually. Okay, come back with a lot of investigation. So the investigation that you may have or teachers may have about the context of teaching is finding out information about what is the level of the students, how long the course is, and where is the course taking place. And the second is to check the appropriateness and effectiveness of the product. This is actually not the ways or techniques that you can find information about the context, but this is only my idea so that I do not forget to tell you that if we have an analysis for the context before designing a course, we will be easier to check the things we have for designing a course is suitable or not, appropriate or not, and whether those things are effective or not for our class, okay, for our teaching. And the third, make you easier to make decision. This is the thing that I mentioned before in the previous slides, that knowing about the context of our teaching, knowing about the students, knowing about the environments, the real physical settings, for example, the people and other factors, and knowing the context are very important, again, to make you easier. So the context, the result of the analysis for context will make us easier to make decision, okay, decision about what to teach and how to teach that. Well, over here, I mentioned some of them before, but that's okay, I'll repeat it. Factors to consider in defining the context. And over here, I have five boxes, you can see. The first is people, the second is physical setting, and the third is nature of the course and institution. The fourth is teaching resources, and the last is time. These five factors actually exist in Kathleen and Grace book. If you read the book, you will find these five, okay? The factors to consider in defining the context. The first is people. People over here, okay, I think I'll just go to the next slide because I have information about it. People. Okay, here it is. People. The people that we need to know to define our course, to get familiar with the context for our teaching, we've got to understand who the people are in our environments, the environments of our teaching. And the people, the main characters for our course are you and your students, right? And beside you, teacher and students, we also have other people, actually, and other stakeholders like school administrators, parents, funders, and community or society. And should you know about every people here, every point I wrote over here, if you have time, you are not busy, even if you are busy, actually, you still need to have intention to try to find information about these people, like students, who your students are, and what about their characteristics, what about their economy. I think those backgrounds, the backgrounds of your students are also important, so that you can decide any activities for your teaching in a wise decision. And what else that we need to know about the students? Of course, the information about their proficiency in English. If you have the students in the second semester, or for example, the second year students, I think that's not too difficult to find information about their previous knowledge or their previous achievement. You can talk to the previous teachers, right? You can talk to the previous teachers. You can also copy the report from the students, from the teachers, or you can also do an interview, actually, or you can give such survey or questionnaires to your students to find or to collect information about their background, their ability, their weaknesses, and others. And survey, I think survey or having questionnaires is also one of the best way to find out rich information about your students, because in one questionnaire, you can have many questions, right? Many questions. And by the time you had already collected that information, I believe you will have a portrait about what to do with your students, okay? What activities are okay for them, and what about their surroundings? This might also put number two, and Grace also told us to have this in our contacts of the stakeholders like school administrators and parents. By the time, for example, for parents, by the time you design an activity for your students later on, and you do not know the conditions of the parents, okay, the parents, will you involve parents in that, for example, homework or a special project, or even you have like home assignment, okay, project, yes, that's project, and will you ask parents to control your students, for example? Of course, that you also need any information about the parent, that's the parents itself, right? You can do a lot actually by knowing the information about the stakeholders like parents, community, funders, and school administrators. And the community over here, the last point for number two are the stakeholders. The community over here, I think, is also very influential in your activity. You can design or create something creative for your teaching. Like my kids, okay, they have homework from school, and the teacher asks the kids to talk or to interview the member of community, so they will find people in community and try to interview those people. Of course, this kind of activity, you can also think about that by the time you find a special topic for your teaching or your learning later on, and you need other people to get involved, you may think about that. Okay, you may think about these other stakeholders. And what about school administrators? Do we need school administrators? Maybe we need them, and maybe we do not need them in some condition. I'm not saying that those people, the people you see in this slide will always be in your teaching, no, okay? So sometimes you may have parents, or maybe you will not have parents, or you will have community, or maybe you will not have community. So the way you decide which one, whose people will get involved in your teaching, you will know it, you will decide that based on the information you receive. That is why having analysis for context of your teaching is important before designing a course, okay? So knowing these people is actually the activity that a designer for a course should done in the beginning of teaching, okay, before or prior designing. Well, we come to the second. So over here, after people, we have physical setting over here, okay? Look at my cursor over here, physical setting. And for physical setting is one of the factors that we need to consider too when we want to design a course. Physical setting is the real setting of the physical things, like the location of the school. Location of the school, whether the class the school is convenient or not, and what about the setting? The setting here means like the position, the real location or position of that school. Is that in the center of a town, or that's in the center of a jungle or what? Okay, you've got to know that information. If you are a new teacher to that school, of course, you've got to find it out, right? But if you are a teacher, you have already been a teacher in that school, of course, that I think the locations of the school, you may get this information. And about the classroom, the next fiscal study information that you may also need to design a course is the condition of your classroom. Okay, what about the size of the classroom? Is that a wide classroom or that's like a narrow classroom or what? And what about the furniture in that school? The light, okay, the light in that school, is that enough or not? Or a condition of teaching, for teaching and learning? And what about noise? You also need to think about the noise in that classroom, whether the class is soundproof or not, because for a language class, you need to anticipate any noise that you will make in your class. For example, in speaking class, will you let your students talk loudly? If you think that speaking is making noise in the classroom and you believe that, of course, that you have to anticipate your neighbor or the class beside you, whether the condition of your class will disturb them or not. Or maybe you may think about something else. If the condition is not convenient for your neighbor, you may choose to go outside, go having teaching and learning process out of the classroom or under the tree. So those information, if you analyze that this kind of context, you can think about the method that you're going to use for your class, okay? That's also one of the reasons why we should add your analysis for our context. And for a classroom, I still have one last point over here. Always same classroom. Will your teaching be conducted in the same classroom or you will change the class? For example, for the first meeting, you will do it in lab, and the second meeting, you will do it in the real classroom, the actual classroom, or for the next meeting, you will have it somewhere else, okay? I think you also need to think about that, okay, so that you may predict or you can design about what to do with your class, okay? You can make a matching the condition of your classroom with your materials that are on and also the activities you will do. Okay, I think physical setting is not really difficult to be understood, and so we'll go to the third. The third factors that you need to define for your course is the nature of course and institution. And for the nature of course and institution, I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, I got 5 points. And these 5 points are, again, they are not mine actually. So the ideas is coming from Kathleen Graves. Look at the first box. Talking about nature of course and institution, this is also an idea about the type of proposal of the course. And mandatory, that's the second box, okay? Mandatory often enrollment, relation to common or previous courses, prescribed curriculum or not, requires tests or not, okay? So nature of course and institution. So these are some examples that you may think and analysis for those points before designing a course, like the type of the purpose of the course. I think for type and purpose of course, if you are teaching in Indonesia and you are teaching in public schools or even in private school, actually our government had already set the competences, right? Purpose of the course in, I can say it in Bahasa Indonesia, curriculum inti and curriculum dasar. And thus, curriculum in the and also curriculum lesson for basic competence of here, they are already set by the government. Jadi mereka sudah ditetapkan oleh pemerintah dalam undang-undang sebetulnya. So, if you want to find a context or type or purpose of course, actually you are not designing from scratch, from zero, okay, from zero. So you just need to learn, okay, the things that you may have before class. I think you need to learn those regulations from the government. What about the competence that have been said by the government itself? Itself, and you learn the document, okay? So you major analyze this, or you can read and try to understand the real document, written curriculum from the government. And mandatory or open enrollment. Mandatory and open enrollment, if you are not like people in chief or like principals, or you are not the people in a curriculum in that school, I think maybe you will have a part for that, okay, and you will think about that activity, like enrollment for students, but maybe not, but also maybe not, okay. So this is actually optional whether you want to find out about this kind of information or not. And whether this book will be useful for your design, I mean your course design or not. And let's go to the yellow. Is this yellow? No, this is light orange. light orange column that is relation to current previous courses. Here, the next analysis for nature of course or institution is the courses itself. The courses themselves. If you are teaching, for example, English subject at senior high school for second year students, of course that you need to know too about the previous or the current courses, what they have learned. I mean, they here is. For students, what your students have learned, what your students have learned in previous years. What is the function of knowing that? The function of knowing that is like here. If you do not, you do not want to know about the previous topics that your students learned in the previous year or in the previous semester, there is a possibility that you will repeat the same topics. You will repeat the same lesson. So to avoid this kind of repetition, and you will have to achieve the goals again. And you may see the confidence set by the government if you are in Indonesia. That's the function, okay, to make an adjustment so that you know which one is okay for the second year and which one is not okay for the second year, and which one is actually should be provided or should be served in the first for the first year students. So yes, this kind of a lot, I mean, that's kind of many things to do if you are a teacher, but if you do it in every step, I believe that this is not too difficult. I mean, we'll talk about where to start, okay, whether you want to start with syllabus, whether you want to start with a lesson plan, and if you didn't know what to start, this will actually help you, okay. If you have already had a portrait or insight about the course, what the context, and you know your beliefs will work whether you want to apply your beliefs or not in that class, and then you can do, okay, which one is appropriate, which one is not, what to teach and what not to teach, okay? Actually, the beliefs is also very important, but I'm not going to talk about the beliefs right now in this video. We'll talk about the beliefs for your language design, your language curriculum design for the next topic, okay? We'll just focus today for knowing a contextual analysis. Okay, let's go to the blue one. Prescribed curriculum or not. prescribed curriculum or not, if you are teaching at senior high school, I think English is still prescribed subject, okay? Prescribed. Not a prescribed subject, but it is a subject which is served for students in senior high school. But if you are teaching at elementary school, for example, you've got to check whether English is one of the, I mean, the subject to be taught to your students or not. But I think the prescribed curriculum here is not talking about that kind of subject. I'm sorry. I think prescribed curriculum or not over here is just like when you are learning, like in our university, we have like speaking one, speaking two, speaking three. And if you are teaching speaking three, make sure that you know the prescribed subject or the prescribed courses before speaking three. So there should be in our campus or in our university, in our department, I mean, we need to have speaking one and speaking two, or speaking for daily conversation, and after that you will go with speaking for public setting, if I'm not mistaken, maybe I'm wrong. And the last is speaking for academic setting, okay? So the hierarchy or the order of that course, you need to know that. And what about the curriculum, I mean the materials here? You also have to know about the hierarchy, I think, the order of the materials. For example, you are teaching the first year student at the first, at junior high school. And you start with present perfect, okay? Present perfect. And after that, on the next semester, you serve present, okay? Of course, that the hierarchy or the orders, I mean, the sequence of the, what did you say that? The sequence of the materials or that times is not appropriate, right? Of course, that we have to learn present first, and after that we learn past, okay? Past or perfect after that. So I think the prescribed curriculum is like that. Okay, if I'm wrong, just let me know. But I think the prescribed curriculum is like that. Required tests or not. Here, for a course, if you design a course, whether you need to have tests or not, it depends, okay, it depends. But for you, as you had been set to be a teacher in senior high school or junior high school, my students in Indonesia, I think you don't have to have required tests in the very first place for your course, because it's not actually a course, but that's only a subject. English is only a subject in that school. I think the required test is for, I think, could be like the first test, or just like diagnostic test in the very first meeting before studying a new topic, okay? And I think that test is for checking the level of the students, whether you want to check their proficiency or in English, okay? Will you use that kind of test or not? It depends on you, okay? It depends on you. So you have to make your own decision whether you want to have that kind of test or not in your class, okay? So the things I mentioned just now, they are actually not a must, okay? Not a must. So you may choose and you may decide for your class, will you use the things I mentioned just now or not? It depends on the situation or the condition of your teaching later on. Okay, I think we need to go up to the next slide because I still have more than 5 slides, I think. Over here, teaching resources. Teaching resources is also one of the factors that we need to know, okay? We need to know, and we need to do analysis for that before designing the course or designing designing a subject like English subject if you are in Indonesia. In Indonesia, what about the teaching resources that we are going to use for our classroom? And over here, I have four different features. The first feature is materials. So the feature is books, okay? Books, but I also brought actually at the bottom of the feature. So the book refers to the materials available. So before starting teaching, you are suggested to check about the books or the textbook or the materials provided in that school. If you are a new teacher and you have your own book and you think that book is not quite good, but if you think that book is good to be used in your class, will you use that or not? Will you have 100% freedom to choose your own materials? The answer is, I don't know. It depends, okay? It depends on your school. It depends on the condition you are at, okay? In some school, maybe you may use your own books, I don't know. But in the schools I know, like my husband's school, where my husband worked at that school, I mean, every teacher in English subject, even in English subject, they may not use their own books before they give that book to the vice principals of curriculum to check the content of that book. After checking the content of that book, and the people in charge, I mean the vice principal in curriculum said that, oh, it's okay to be used in our school, then the teacher can use that book. But I don't know in other schools, okay? And you must be very careful too if you are teaching at boarding school, because they have their own mission and vision for schools and specific materials. Sometimes they need to have like integrated materials. Let's say, for example, Islamic boarding school. In Islamic boarding school, they will try to integrate the curriculums. So the general curriculum from the government and also the curriculum from the boarding school itself, which is Islamic view or Islamic value, I mean. So if you use a book which is not suitable with the Islamic rules, for example, and the content of that book are not suitable with the teaching of Islam, and then you, of course, you may not use that book, okay? Because you just win the mission or the vision of that school to combine any kind of things in that school with the rules of Islamic view or Islamic teaching, I mean. Okay, that's for the materials available. Make sure that you do the analysis for the materials. Whether the materials are suitable for your school or not, whether the students will feel difficult or not to read that book, and whether you can use that book in a good way. I mean that you can be an expert one for that book or not, whether you can deliver the materials in that book or not. So you've got to think about those things, okay, before designing a course, before you start teaching or you start designing your lesson plan or your syllabus. And the next teaching resources that you need to know is text, required text. What kind of text are here? Text is just like a script text. What do you think about that? Or narrative text? Whether the curriculum will use text, I mean the approach for text or text approach or general based text or not, you've got to find it out, okay, whether the school uses that kind of text or not. And if that school doesn't use that kind of approach, maybe you will not do that, or you will do that, I don't know, okay? I cannot say yes or no. It depends on your condition, okay? It depends on teacher's condition. It depends on the context where a teacher teaches, okay? So that's my answer. And that's also what Kathleen Graves answered, I think, because I also got the ideas from this book from Kathleen Graves. And the third picture over here is, what is that? I think that it's just like trust, but that's not a trust, okay? The point for this picture is to develop own materials. Can you develop your own materials or not, okay? The answer for yes or no, again, you are the one who will know the answer, okay? You find information about this school and you check whether the school allows you to have your own or not. But I think if it is only developing on materials, I think that's going to be okay because you do not create that from scratch and you just develop the materials. And the fourth is equipment. For teaching resources, before teaching and before you decide which one of the method you will use for your teaching and what about the strategies, what kind of approach for teaching English, for example, for teaching that language to a student, make sure that you know the facilities in that school. Make sure that you have information about the equipment available in that school. The examples are like cassettes, video, photocopying, printer, or even microphone, if you think that microphone is important in your class. And what about if you don't have it? Then by knowing this context, by knowing the resources in that school, by knowing the teaching resources, like equipment in that school, you can think about, you can think and you can plan, okay? You can plan your teaching and learning process in the classroom. That's why, again, I say doing analysis for your context and your teaching context is important, okay? That's essential. And the next, I think this is the last pages that we need to define in designing a course. This is about time. And I have several questions, and the questions are not mine actually. So the questions are the questions from Kathleen. Okay, Kathleen. So I got these questions from Kathleen again. And let me read. Number one, how many hours total over what span of time? And the second, how often class meets? For how long each time? That's number three. And for day of week, time of day, where fits the schedule of students' timelines. I'm sorry, they are actually not questions, they are just the points, okay? My points, because I just did the summary. So I didn't write any full questions, so they are just in a form of points, I'm sorry. I think from the points I just read, I think you can understand, right? You can understand that when you try to define the time, you need information about how many hours one meeting will be, okay? Usually at school, in Indonesian school, the times range between 40 minutes until 45 minutes for one meeting. And how often class meets? Sometimes in Indonesian class at the high school, senior high school, two times in a week, or even one time in a week, I don't know. So that's the teacher's job to find out, okay, whether that school apply two times meeting in a week or one time or even three times or maybe always. Always here means that every day they will have English class. I don't know. Okay, that's your job as a teacher to find that out. And the third is how long each time, whether in one meeting, the example is just like allocation of time or the duration of your teaching. If it is 2 hours, it means that one teaching hour will be 40 minutes. If it is 2 meeting hours in one meeting, it means that 40 minutes times 2, okay? It should be 80 minutes. And if the total hour for one meeting is 45 minutes, it means that you just need to time whether the subject will be served for two teaching hours. If it is two teaching hours, it means that 45 minutes times two. So it should be, how many? 45 times two, it means that 90 minutes. And day of week, time of day, okay? In what day you will be teaching. And why this point is important? Yes, this point could be important if you are teaching at, for example, if you are teaching at a boarding school. On Friday, let's say that your schedule is on Friday, and in that boarding school, of course, on Friday, usually people go to mosque to do the prayer, right? And maybe there is an influence for that. Maybe yes, maybe no, I don't know. So day of week, maybe you will have something with the day, okay, to decide to your teaching and learning. Maybe not, okay? The next is work fits and schedule of students. I think if you are teaching in Indonesia, it doesn't matter whether it fits the student schedule or not. The students should follow the schedule decided by the schools, right? So I think this point is not for Indonesian context. I mean, like you are teaching in public school or private schools. Maybe it fits with homeschooling. Maybe homeschooling will do that. Or maybe if you design a course, I mean, like private course, or you design a course abroad, maybe you will need to fit the schedule of the students. Okay, if it's the schedule of the students, it means that you've got to arrange the schedule based on the time available from students, and you make a match with your schedule. I guess like that. And the last point is students' timelines. Student time, but I think this is often not too significant if you're teaching in Indonesia in public schools, okay, student timelines. But maybe timelines over here, just like the things that need to do for students in their classes. Maybe they have more than one subject in 1 week, and you've got to think about assignments or the homework that you will get to your students based on the time. What about the deadline? Will the deadline will be in a similar 15 other classes or not? If it is similar with the other 15 classes, of course, that it will become a big burden for a student to complete 15, okay? To complete 15 assignments or 15 homework in the same time. Maybe you can talk and discuss about that if you find that case, okay? That's one of the functions why we learned about how to analyze this time. Okay, we've done with all of the factors that need to define when you design a course. Now we go to the slide. Why is it important to define one's context? I guess I just mention and explain you why in the previous slides, okay? Because it can help us to focus to what is realistic and what is not realistic to our class, and which what is appropriate for our class, or I mean for our teaching or even course, and which one is not. If you do not have, let's say that you do not have any information for the context for your teaching, how could you become focused to the things that you will design? What kind of methods you will apply to your class? What kind of activities you will provide to your students? Maybe let's say that you can design activities based on your knowledge, based on theories, based on your beliefs. But I'm not sure that the theories you have and also the activities you made will be realistic or will be suitable with your students' condition, will be suitable with your class condition, okay? That is why we need to do analysis for the context of our teaching so that we can be easier to be focused on what real estate for our class, okay? What is appropriate for our class. And the next is pre-course needs assessment. I think I did mention this before, so just skip this one. Well, we've done with all factors and the function of having analysis for the contacts and problematizing. This is one of the way to check, okay? Problematizing is one of the ways to check whether your information you receive or you collected for your teaching will be realistic or will be appropriate. And how do you know that the things you will design will be realistic? And how do you know that the medias or the activities will be appropriate for your student in that school? So the way to know the answer, you've got to problematize, okay? You problematize yourself, you question yourself, looking at something that is taken for granted, looking at what you know about the context and dividing the challenges you feel you need to and are able to meet in order to make the course successful. So that's problematizing. For example, about class size, multi-level, number of hours. You give questions to yourself, okay? You question. If I do these activities, for example, if I do these activities to the students in this class size for speaking focus class, for example, will it be okay? Will it be successful, or will it have no problem with your neighbors, for example? So the question like this will help you to answer whether the things you have for your teaching, I mean the design of your course, will be realistic or not, will be appropriate or not. So problematize, that is problematizing. Problematizing helps you to decide where to start, okay? The second point, look at this, okay? The second point over here. So problematizing is very important to help you decide where to start and what to focus on in planning the course. And I myself actually also feel confused where to start when I was asked by my chair of department to write a module for curriculum and course design. Where to start? What information should I have? Should I start with syllabus and inform my students that the first step in designing a course is having syllabus, or I start with lesson plan, or I start with prota? You know, prota is just like a year program or annual program for that school, for that course. Or I will start with the passing grade, or I will start with the allocation of time. So when to start and what to start, okay? When to start and what to start, you've got to problematize that. And how could you problematize when to start and when to start? If you have information about the real or the actual condition of your teaching and learning, okay? Who knows that at school you are teaching, the syllabus is actually active, for example. So you don't need to use to design a new syllabus from scratch. You just need to develop the syllabus, for example, and you just need to create your own lesson plan or FAP. You don't listen to no FAP lesson plan. So it helps a lot actually if you know the context or the situation in the school, the situation for your teaching, okay? And those 5 points I mentioned before, 5 factors to define, okay? Like people, physical setting, teaching resources, nature, and also the time, nature of the resources and nature of the materials, and the time, okay? If you know those information, it will be easy, and you know, and you can decide where to start, whether you want to start with syllabus, whether you want to start with the materials, or whether you want to start with the passing grade, or or maybe not, okay? That's the passion. And problematizing is about making choices for action. Yes, if you problematize the things you have, the information you got from your analysis, I mean, the contextual analysis, you will know what to decide for your class. So after you know what is that to your class, you problematize again, you question again whether that is realistic or not, whether that is, whether that's going to be appropriate or not for your class. So problematizing is important to make choices for actions, okay? The action, yeah, the last. So after you plan, you will do the actions. Okay. In this slide, I don't have a lot of points. I just have these words. Not every teacher has the freedom to create a course from scratch. So define your context, okay? This is actually a reminder for us, for you and I, that if we face or we are going to teach a new student or a new student in a new classroom or even in a new school or even in a new university, you've got to understand that every teacher has the freedom to create a course from scratch. So let's say that you are a brilliant person and you have a lot of thinking, a lot of beliefs, and you know what to do, you know your own action to apply it. You know what action you need to do with the classroom, which one is good and which one is not. But again, you have to do analysis whether you can have your right to design, your freedom to create a course or not. If you are teaching at any high school or junior high school or even vocational high school, as long as you are teaching in Indonesia, so for secondary school, the government actually had already set the things that you can develop, the things you cannot develop, like the basic competence or the competences in teaching, and also the time allocation, for a course. It has all those things had been set by the government, so it means that you do not have a freedom from scratch. It means from zero. Your job is not to design from the beginning, from zero, but you just need to develop, okay? To develop the curriculum, not from scratch. And even if you do not start that from a scratch and you do not start that from zero, again, you still need to define your context, okay? Your context is very important because your context will help you focus to decide anything about your class, okay? The methods, the activities, and others. Well, my students, I think that's all my explanation about contextual analysis. I hope you can understand it. And if you don't understand, you may ask me, okay? You may ask me or comment on the comment section or comment on Google Classroom or chat me through WhatsApp. And for the rest, for your next assignment will be on Google Classroom. So just check your Google Classroom for the following activities that we will do. That's all. Thank you so much. See you.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.